Okay, I'm Steve Mace from Solwise, and what I'd like to do is a quick under the bonnet type video of the EnStation5-AC product from EnGenius. Now the EnStation5-AC is a point-to-point wireless bridge device using 5 gig 11ac wave 2 with a maximum Wi-Fi speed of 867 meg. Which I suppose gives a circa realistic maximum throughput of about 400 meg, assuming obviously interference-free bands, blah, 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 blah. But it gives you an idea of the performance capabilities it's potentially capable of. So, as you can see from the picture, this is one of these dish-type products. If I click on there, we can actually get a bigger, better picture. So it's about 6 inches dish, and built into the front, we've got two 19 dB cross-polarized antenna operating obviously at the 5 gig band. So let's have a look at the web interface and go through the setup and see what we can find out. So the web interface is on the default address 192.168.1.1, and the default login is admin. Type admin. Okay, so this is the default setting that it comes up with. So we're on the default status page for it, and as you can see, it's still not set. It's still got Netherlands as the country. I don't know why it has Netherlands as a country. Perhaps it's because EnGenius Europe is now based in the Netherlands. And we can see that the standard default operating mode is access point mode, with it set on channel 100. So these are pretty much the default settings of the product. Now, let's go through the important parts of the setup for it. So if I go into basic, this is probably the first thing you want to look at. This is essentially where you set what IP address you want the unit to be on. By default, it should be on 1.1 or DHCP, but obviously you can change this to any IP address that suits your network. So once you've done that, we can go straight to wireless setup, which is more important. So the first thing you're going to want to do is change the country from Netherlands to UK. Now, in actual fact, this makes no difference as far as I can tell. Now the whole of the EU has got conformity with its 5 gig bands, its output power, its channels, etc. So changing it from Netherlands to United Kingdom doesn't really, as far as I can tell, make any difference at all. The other thing to look at on here is we have this button here called green. Now, green ticked means make sure that you conform to all of the proper standards for the country you've chosen, i.e. the frequency bands, channels, RF output power, etc., etc. Untick green and you've got more flexibility to boost the power past the legal limits, etc. We'll leave it ticked for green. Operational mode, and as I say at the start, this is really intended as a point-to-point Wi-Fi bridge device. So connect building A to connecting building B over a transparent Ethernet connection. But it does have other mode built into it, mainly because this is the firmware really which can be found on other of their products with other functions. So, it, for example, it has access point and WDS access point, etc., WDS station, all this sort of thing. For the purposes of 9 out of 10 applications for this, all people are interested in is a point-to-point WDS bridge. So we'll tick WDS bridge. Next thing to look at is the HT mode. Well, by default, it's 40 megahertz, but this is an 11ac product, so you really want to be pushing it to the maximum, so you need to be picking 80 meg. For the HT mode. Now the next thing is the configuration of the channels. Now channel usage in the UK slash EU, this is showing the 80 meg wide channels available. Now these bottom four channels, 36 through to 48, they are what we used to call in the UK band A, and are strictly for indoor use only. So you can't select any of those. So the fact that it's come up the default channel 36, you can't use that. For outdoor usage, we need to be using these higher channels here, 100 to 112. So let's just pick 100, and let's click on save. So now we've selected the channel. Now, on this screen, the next thing you would probably want to do is setting up as a WDS bridge. Now, WDS bridge is set on the MAC addresses of the units that are bridging. So what I mean by that is the left-hand unit will do a WDS bridge to the right-hand unit, but to do that, you must put the MAC address of the right-hand unit in here. The counter direction, the opposing unit needs to have the MAC, your MAC address set in here. So notice this can cope with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, is that 8? 8, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 8. So 8 different MAC addresses. So potentially you could bridge to 8 other devices. Of course, that's a bit of a stupid thing to do because it only has a highly directional antenna built in. So unless the 8 devices are all bang in a straight line, then that's a bit rubbish. Really, you'd be doing this as a single point-to-point link. So all you would do is click on enable for there and put the MAC address of the other link that you want to bridge to in this setting. The other thing to look at here on this setup page here is the security. Security on a WDS bridge link, in my opinion, isn't really anything to worry about because the devices will only talk to each other as specified by this fixed MAC address. However, if you're getting really, really, really paranoid, yes, you can go ahead and put some security on that link. I don't think it's worth worrying about, but whatever. So once you've done all that, the none of the settings on this screen really matter at all. You've got an RSSI threshold. That only really matters in your access point mode. And what it means is if the client is weak, it'll kick it off to go look for another access point. Immaterial when using WDS bridge. So there's nothing really else on this screen that you need to even think about when you're doing WDS bridge. So recap, WDS bridge, 80 meg wide channels, go and choose an operating channel to work on, a Wi-Fi channel to work on, come down to the bottom, enable the first MAC address, I claimed this box enable here, and just put the MAC address of the other unit in. Now what you're trying to do here, obviously, just to remind you, is you put in the MAC address of the Wi-Fi interface of the other unit in here. And then all we will do is we will click save. So what this does is it saves the settings, but what it doesn't do is it doesn't apply the settings. To apply the settings, we have to click on this button here. Now, one useful feature of these latest generation of EnGenius products is you can do a whole pile of changes and just apply them all in one go at the end. Older products, you tend to find that every time you do a change, you have to apply it, you have to wait, I don't know, 1 or 2 minutes for the thing to apply the changes and restart, etc. With the latest generation EnGenius products, you can do all the changes in one go. So no necessary playing around and mucking around and wasting time. So I won't bother clicking that just yet till we can show you some of the other features of the product. So if we go continue down this menu items, we've got advanced. In here, it has the capabilities to put a controller in. Yet again, waste of time as far as I can see, because the controller, I'm guessing, would be the neutron controller, and the neutron controller only actually supports products in access point mode. We're using WDS bridge, so redundant field. Ignore it. SNMP settings, if you actually wanted to go through an SNMP process of management. At the bottom, you've got email alert if things go wrong with it, etc., etc., etc. Yet again, not really interested in playing out with those functions. Time zone, obviously setting the time of the product. Wi-Fi scheduler. This might actually be useful. You can do a periodic reboot if you think it needs it. Shouldn't need it, to be honest. But also, you've got this thing called Wi-Fi schedule. So you can actually turn the Wi-Fi on and off certain times of day. So I suppose what you could do there is you could actually turn the WDS bridge off, or the link off, at certain times of day, out of office hours or something like that. You know. Tools, you've got the usual pings and speed tests and all that sort of thing. And finally, at the bottom, we've got ability to change the login details for it, ability to do firmware update for it, and basic log of what's going on with the product. So that's all the settings. As you can see, there really isn't much to do in this, setting this up. Get your IP addresses correct, then quick setup of the WDS bridge, and that's it. So now what we can do is we're now in a position to apply all these changes now. So apply. Now it does take a while doing this. Off the top of my head, I think we're talking around about a minute and a half, 90 seconds, something like that, to actually apply all these changes. It gives you an idea of what changes it's specifically applying as it goes through. So I don't really know what etc config network is, but I'm guessing it's doing those network changes that we set up for it. And it's just basically a case of sat around twiddling thumbs. So while that's going on, I'm going to have a swig of my espresso. And a damn good cup of espresso that was as well. None of this pod crap that's all the rage at the moment. Proper drink made out of proper ground beans. Done. So, you see, the country is now correctly set to United Kingdom. And if we go further down, we can see it's now correctly set in WDS bridge mode and correctly set on channel 100. And that is it. So as you can see, it's not rocket science to set this product up. It really is simple. Word of advice, when you're playing around with any of these sort of products, set them up on our office desk before nailing them to the outside wall, just in case you forget to do something. But honestly, configuration is dead easy. Thank you very much.